I'm Kirk Hansen. I'm Executive Director of the Markkula Center for Applied Ethics at Santa Clara University. And we're privileged to have as a guest at the center today, Simon Lorne, who's Vice Chair and Chief Legal Officer of Millennium Management, a hedge fund management company. Cy has a distinguished career in law, and he started out as a partner at Munger, Tolles & Olson. He was General Counsel of the Securities and Exchange Commission. He was a managing director at Solomon Brothers, returned to Munger, Tolles & Olson, and then in 2004 was asked to go to Millennium Management as the vice chair and chief legal officer with responsibility for compliance and for internal audit. He represents a new trend in the rising status of internal audit as a part of the corporate structure, the rising importance of it as a part of establishing and enforcing standards of ethics and compliance. Cy, thank you for being with us.
My pleasure.
My first question is really, what's happened to the role of the internal auditor? It seems since 2002, maybe from Sarbanes-Oxley and through Dodd-Frank, its status has been raised dramatically in the corporation. Is that true?
I think that's right. I think there is increasing recognition of the importance and value of the internal audit function. Some part of that probably comes from Sarbanes-Oxley, which put a lot of emphasis on internal controls. And concomitant with that, people recognized the function as an important part of the internal control of the organization. I think it's very hard to run an organization without a strong internal audit function.
Are you unique in being a vice chair and head of internal audit? Is that does that happen elsewhere?
That may not. I do have other responsibilities as well as internal audit, but I think it is happening elsewhere that people are recognizing the importance of the function and the value of it.
Mm-hmm. What I'd be interested in is how the task itself of the social auditor has expanded. Are social auditors expected to do more in the organization than they were a decade ago?
I think that's probably right. I think all of the internal control functions are doing more and expected to do more. I think more chief executives and boards of directors are focusing on internal audits. I think slippage is a lot less acceptable than it was 10 years ago, mm-hmm. and the consequences of mistakes are higher than they were, and you put all of that together, I think the boards of directors are demanding, and in turn, CEOs are demanding that the internal audit function be strong, that it dig into everything. People in those positions on the board, CEOs, want to find out if something's wrong before anybody else does. They don't want to find out the hard way.
You're deeply involved in ethics and compliance across the board with the several functions that report to you. In your talk today, you referred to the fact that you believe there was the need for both a short and a long form of the statement of the standards of the organization. What's the short form and what's the long form, and what role do they each play?
Well, the long form tends to be a code of ethics that runs to 15 or 20 pages and gets into detailed behavior about the ethical obligations of employees, et cetera. That might work in some organizations. In our organization, the people involved are used to quick decisions, moving very fast, and frankly, they don't have the patience for a 20 or 30 page code of ethics. I want them to have something that they will read and understand the importance of ethics. And so we have a very short policy. It says, I can quote it almost verbatim, it says, do the right thing. Obey the laws and the firm's policies. Respect the personal and property rights of others. And do the right thing. If it's not clear what is right under the circumstances, ask someone.
So it's kind of a what's been referred to as a principles or a values-based approach in addition to more of a compliance.
It is.
Rules
and it communicates what I want our people to know. It communicates that we care about those things, that we want them to do the right thing, quite simply, and that we want them to ask people if they have problems. And That's all I really want them to do. I want them to know what our policies are and to follow them. But most important, the principal thing, the principal, is to do the right thing under all circumstances.
If a company has a detailed compliance code and no short form or short statement of its values and principles and ethics, what risk does it run?
It runs the risk, I think, that people won't read it, that people will ignore it. And then it's simply not sending any message. And it looks a little bit like something that's prepared for public consumption rather than prepared to try to really get people to adhere to it.
And show the government auditor when they show up.
That's right. And you know, we live in a regulated industry, and it's important to have policies that you can show the government, but I really care about policies that will work, that will get our people to stay within the law.
Okay. You're deeply involved in the Directors College at a neighboring institution I used to be associated with at Stanford. You look at corporate governance in that context with great care. What would you expect of a chief internal audit officer? What's a good one? When you look at one, what would be a good internal auditor?
I want somebody who is thinking about the job, who is paying attention to it, who has some attention to detail, who will run a good team. Internal audit needs to be a team approach, and obviously you worry about management skills and all of those things that you worry about in any corporate position. But I care about integrity. I care about judgment. I care about the ability to recognize when things are important and when things are trivial. I care about the ability to dig in and find out what's really going on in a situation.
Some people have said one of the great characteristics is the person who's willing to buck the system or to take things to the audit committee if they need to be taken. How do you know if somebody has that kind of backbone, moral courage to do that when it's necessary?
Well, I want somebody who stands up to me. I want somebody who if I'm getting a little lax, or if he or she thinks I'm getting a little lax, isn't afraid to say so. And I am more comfortable in that situation than I would be with somebody telling me that I'm doing the right thing. At one point I was hiring a chief compliance officer, chief ethics officer at the SEC. And I told that person that there were two key qualities. The most important thing was to be able to say no to the chairman. And the second most important thing was to be able to say yes to the chairman. And I need the balance. I need somebody who recognizes the right balance, who has the backbone to say no, but is also strong enough and reliant enough on his or her own judgment to recognize when it's okay to say yes.
And in talking to boards, what's a good CEO in terms of the ethics and values of the organization? How does a board know if they've got somebody who's up to the task of creating an ethical culture?
I think a key, maybe not the only key, but one of the keys, is the information flow. Does the CEO have enough confidence in herself or himself and in the people under the CEO to have information flow directly from those people to the board rather than always being filtered through the CEO? That's one of the tests I like to apply. And if I'm on a board, I want to make sure I have access to the general counsel, to the head of internal audit, to the chief compliance officer, to the CFO. I want unfettered access, and I want a CEO who is not troubled by giving me that access.
Fascinating. Well, thank you for sharing your wisdom with us today and for the work that you do in this critically important field.
My pleasure, and thank you for the work you're all doing.